coming to you live from the Conversation Room, deep in the heart of the Central Valley. This is the Almond Man Podcast, hosted by the one and only Russell Harris. Are you ready to get nuts?
All right, man. Welcome to the All Men Man Podcast. Today we have round two with Conrad De La Torre. Let's talk about the first time we ever met. The first time I ever met, I met you on the Cross Ranch, which is in north of Chacho, a little bit off Highway 99. Right. Remember that?
Yes,
and I was irrigating. I was irrigating my grapes at that time.
You were.
You pull up in a brand new Chevy truck, Dave Wilson nursing on it and the side because we're getting ready to buy some trees. And I remember discussing, I was working price between you and Birchall, but I really liked Dave Wilson's quality. Mm-hmm. That's why I really wanted your trees, because you guys did such a great job. And I remember I was going to plant 182 trees the acre and try it on my sister's place that we were planting on. That's quite a bit back in the hedgerow,
right,
like they used to have up in UC Davis, remember?
Right, 22 by 11.
22 by 11 on the south side of the river. And the other side of the river, I went and put, I think, standard plantings, 110. So anyways, I remember buying those trees from you. They were almost like $4.75 back in 1993.
Yes.
Because I planted so many trees there, I go, gosh dang, man. There's a lot of money to be made in this thing. So you gave me, actually inspired me to get in the nursery business, other than saving money for my father, because, man, that was a lot of profit, I thought.
Well, when you're talking about that many trees per acre, it gets really expensive.
Real expensive. Mm-hmm. And then I try to hire you a little bit.
It didn't work. We tried. We talked about it. I don't know. 10, 15, 20 times probably.
Yeah, yeah. Well, so I think I was in business. I started in 94, and I think you came on in 2004. So it was 10 years I was out peddling trees. Me and Dave Bazaar, I was the truck driver, and he was a scheduler. And I remember we couldn't even count bundles, man. Bundles would be all, because we tried to count them in the field. We wanted a field pack.
Right.
You guys were out there when you were always loading on trailers and had a lot more sizing and grading. Mm-hmm. We never wanted to do that, just to cut right down the cost. So I think that actually saved me quite a bit of as money as well.
Well, yes, because, I mean, the way we were doing it, you take them out of the field, you bring them in, process them by size, you're just a lot of handling. And that actually, it's a great way to get a good count, especially if you're sizing, but then you overhandle trees and it can cause a lot of damage to the trees itself. So when I came here, of course, I looked at how you were doing it, and so I followed what you were doing and made it work. So we still do it today.
Well, I think the industry's changed back then some since now, because they used to do size. Do we still sell a lot of size ourselves?
No, we do not know size. We do no sizes.
We got all jumbos, right?
We do all row run, 3/8 and up. Mm-hmm. And of course, our size average is in the 1/2 inch, 5/8. But we've been doing this for 16 years now, 15 years since I started.
Together.
And it's worked really well, and growers like it because it's a flat price. And one of the things that I like about it is that we dig them that day, we process them, load them on the trailer, the grower plants them the next day, so the tree never felt a thing. And we try to do about 80-85% of our product delivered that way.
Right.
So no handling, no scuffs, no marks.
I remember. I know who was suggesting that was a very good idea.
That was you. I evaluated the cost of doing it the other way, and it really wasn't worth it. I thought it was a great idea to keep it going. So,
well, anyways, I want to talk about you and our partnership more. It's easy to start talking about all that stuff. It just flows natural, comes. So you came to Waite in 2004. I hired your brother.
Yes.
Okay. And give me some of the first time I hired you. It was a big step for you. I
mean,
we talked a long, long time. You had another business, a photo business.
I had a photography business in Modesto that my wife would run. And at the time, and so anyway, when I came up here, the experience was really kind of scary. You had a Navigator, a white Navigator, remember? A Lincoln Navigator. Mm-hmm. And you said, you can borrow that. So I said, okay. And so I would come in early in the morning to the office, and I was just, what have I done? Because, I mean, you're kind of scared. It's a major change in your life.
You were there since you were 13 years old.
Yeah. So, well, it was a major change because the unknown. But when I came in, and then I remember going to the Tulare show at that point, came back, and then just kind of started fitting in. And before we know it, we were going really well. So it was very scary. Very scary, but were it very well worth it.
Give me some of your memories when when you started work. I think how many trees did we grow when you came?
You had planted 1.2 million that year.
Seeds. Okay.
That I, you know, pretty much had to do whatever I had to do with them. And of course, you had hired Raul, my brother, without even me knowing that you had hired him 3 or 4 months before. Mm-hmm. So anyway, that was kind of a relief, because then I figured, okay, I'm going to have a little help here. Not that I needed it, but anything helps. So my thing was that when we came here, of course, dealing with all new help, all new labor that had no idea what growing nursery stock was like. They'd never seen a budding or tying anything done with a tree. So that was the biggest challenge.
It was the most seeds I've ever planted. I think I almost doubled. I think the most I ever grew before you were coming on was like 600,000 seeds. So I doubled it. And I think we grew that on Danny Madalena's ranch, right?
Yes.
That's right.
Yes. The biggest challenge was at that time figuring out how I was going to bud 1.2 million with no staff.
I think I was getting out of town or something.
You were going to go to a nut conference, and I remember telling my brother Raul, I need 10 guys that we feel are going to stick around for a while, and I want them here tomorrow. We're going to go cut some budwood.
Because that's typically in the nursing today. You need solid guys all the time to be do your budding, to do the critical work to the tree. So the environment you came from, you had all kind of staff full of years, and my staff was very limited to have that.
You didn't have anything. I
know. Well, thank you. I had a dream and I got you. That's what I had. So
you had had nothing, but that was the toughest part, because I told him I still need to take them out to the field and cut the budwood, and that way they know, and then we're going to have them trim them, and then from there we're going to go have and start training how to bud them, how to bud.
Yeah.
So it was a process so that they understood where that budwood came from, how it got processed, and then what they're going to do with it afterwards. So I remember that we started, had 10 guys, and we started training them how to bud. And you came by the second day, I think the second day, and you said, well, how many trees did you do? I said, well, about 800 a piece. And you did the math, it's 1.2 million. You'll finish sometime in September, October. And I just kind of, my heart fell to the ground, because I said, oh, gosh, yeah, he's doing the math already, you know. So, but that actually pushed me harder, because, I mean, we were training the staff, and those guys got better, and then we added two more new ones every day. That was our focus.
I remember.
And I remember you went to the conference. I think you were there for about 10 days or 2 weeks, something like that.
Vacation and that.
But anyway, when we got started, by the time you came back, we had 42 budders that we had trained. And we finished budding at about the fifth week.
I remember.
So we finished that, and it was a really good crop that year. I mean, we had a really good stand. And so that was the biggest challenge. And then, of course, the rest of it was not so difficult, because it was just a matter of a supervisor showing a crew and managing.
I remember you were out. You were the supervisor.
I was out there counting trees and making sure that, you know, everybody was doing what they were supposed to be doing. And
we had rose butters come too.
I think
they had bicycles.
I had five rose butters, and that I had to get them off the carts, otherwise they couldn't do it. And they wanted to try it, so we. Out of the 5 week, got two to work. The other three couldn't make it. So it's a lot of times.
I remember you did such a good job, Conrad, that when we negotiated our deal, that we, you know, agreed on a salary. And I got to tell you, folks, when it was more beneficial, because you butted them cheaper than I ever had before.
Well, of course.
after about 1 year, you go, Harris, you took advantage of me. No, I didn't. I gave you exactly what you asked for, did I not?
No, you're right. You're right. Well, I mean, that was what it was. So, I mean, you know, when you train your own staff and you do your own, it's a lot cheaper, obviously, because you have so much in it. When you have somebody come in and do it all for you, it's a package deal.
Yeah, I get it. Sometimes it's worth to do that, too, just to get it done, you know?
Oh, absolutely. Well, you always want to cover it, but I think, you know, then from there it all started. So then we started focusing on giving guys bonuses. We tracked all their, you know, percentages and got people
every row
to come back every year.
Yes, we do every row. I see you. Every row out there's got every name, where the bud came from. You've taken me from being unprofessional to the most professional nursery, I think, or at least in the state. We're equal.
Well, we try to follow the record so we can always track it.
Well, it's because you've had lots and lots of experience. You know,
been doing it for a long time.
long time.
We just followed that. So it was fun. I mean, at the end of the year, it was really rewarding, a lot of hard work, but that's what it takes.
2004, and we started 1.2. And today, how many trees are we?
We plant about almost 4 million and sell about 3.2 because of your losses of budding. And since we do a lot of Peshawar hybrids and we do our own, you have some losses, but we're averaging a little over 3.2 million.
I'm impressed. It's not easy.
Done very well.
Yeah, we sold as high as 5, I think, one year, right?
One year. The biggest year we've ever had was 4.5, almost 4.6 million.
And then, so that is why the price of almonds are probably coming down, because people started planting a lot of trees back in those days.
Right.
You know, it's all cyclical.
It all started. I mean, when I came here, of course, you know, the dominant rootstock was Nemegard.
Right.
Level.
Yeah, this transition, we should talk about that. How it's transitioned so much from 2004 till today. Why don't you just give the varieties and the rootstocks and
absolutely. When we started here, of course, at that time, 05 was probably it was still okay. And then 06 it started. 05, 06, 07. 08 and 09, it was all Butte Padre. The demand for Butte Padre was huge.
On Nemegard mostly
and Lovell. And so we were growing, I remember growing almost half and half of our inventory was all Butte Padres. And then it changed in late 09, and in 010 we went back to Nonpareil and started going with Nonpareil, Monterey, your standard varieties.
Nonpareils were like 20, 30 cents a pound higher back in those days too, like apples and oranges, you know.
Well, there was a spread, right?
And then,
and of course, you know, the Nonpareil's always been the king of the hill, demanded a little more spread there, mm-hmm. so it was better. So since there was a lot of Butte Padres planted prior, then they decided that there was a little shortage of Nonpareil, so everybody went back. And now, of course, you know how that shifted to Nonpareil. Now they want Butte Padres again in today's world,
right? I'm
actually
planting some.
Yes, and so that happens. It just kind of shifts back and forth, and the balance and the buyer and what the, you know,
supply
what they want.
Demand. Supply and demand.
Numbers, right?
Don't lie.
So when we got started, it was all Nemegard Level, and that went pretty strong all the way about till 2013, 2014. And then the demand for Peach Almond hybrids, because we were going into all the data showed from the university that Hansen, your Bright's hybrid, Viking.
The more vigorous rootstocks.
We're producing. Right, because of all the water issues that we're having, the salts, you know, longevity of the orchards, you know, disease prevention, salt tolerance, better anchorage, you know, longer lived.
It was a slow transition, kind of.
Very slow. So we started playing with it.
But for most people out there, they don't know. It's hard to get a hybrid. It's not a natural, like you can't plant a seed and actually get it. It's very difficult.
No. Actually, when the first year I played with hybrid when I came here, was when we had the nursery in Madera.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So that first year that we had there, I remember the day before, I bought 15,000 hybrids from a lab in Oregon, and I brought them in and we planted them.
I remember.
And we tried that for the first time and trying to learn how to do it. And so we had some issues, but kind of made it work, and then we kind of worked out the issues. The following year we increased it to 20, and then we went to 30, and so the transition was really slow trying to figure out how to do it. So by the time we got to about 2014, we were purchasing almost 1 million trees mm-hmm. at that time mm-hmm. from this lab, and the issues that we were having was quality issues of the roots going around in circles. You remember that it was always kind of a little problem because of the tree growing in a little sock.
Yeah, they were all learning together. They got all that fixed.
It's part of the process of learning, right?
Yes, yeah.
So then
We're
still learning. It never ends. And so then we decided, okay, we need to, if we want to have full control of quality and of course, quality and quantity, we need to start learning how to do it ourselves. So,
well, we did it to save money.
We did it to save money mainly,
and try to
get
the quality up.
And when you have control in-house, it's a lot better, because then now you can pretty much decide what you're going to do, when you're going to do it. Mm-hmm. And you have more control over it.
Sure.
So the outcome was learning in the first year.
Hey, we paid for our mistakes. We made a lot of them.
A lot of mistakes. I hired a guy to come in and tell us, and I mean, it cost a lot of money to do it originally, but we figured it out. Yeah. And
mastered
but it's a long, it's been a long haul.
I think you mastered it.
So at one time we were purchasing $1 million. Now we're growing about $2.5 million, almost $3 million in-house ourselves.
It's impressive.
So we do it all ourselves.
I like taking taking growers over there, or you know, some of our buyers. They dig that nursery, how you do it. You know, it's pretty cool looking.
This whole thing has changed, and you know, we've gone from hand planting to machine planting. All this is really been a big learning curve.
Labor is expensive.
Labor.
It's all about labor.
It's all about labor, and of course we don't make a change unless it's as good as, if not better than what we're doing, mm-hmm. right? I mean, saving money is great, but the quality has to be there.
So we went from Nemigards to almost 100% hybrids and different.
Yes.
How many different rootstocks are you growing out there now?
Right now, we're growing mainly four. Well, you got Bright's Hybrid, which is our own selection of GT2.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have Hansen. You have, of course, we're growing a lot of a root pack. Growing a lot of Viking. That's one that, you know, over the years I've talked about that rootstock being, you know, the kind of the rootstock of the future for replacement of Nemigard that has your salt tolerance, it has better anchorage, it has drought tolerance. It's just a really good rootstock. The problem with that rootstock in the past years has been they always talked about the rootstock dehydrating, and the failure rate from the nursery to the growers was really bad. Always a problem.
So you've solved that.
And I experienced that, because when I was at Dave Wilson, we were always fighting that all the time. And so once the patent ran out on the Viking, we started playing with it, and we figured out how to fix it. So we solved that problem, and now we do. Last year I did 250,000. This year I'm almost doing 400,000. Next year it's $1 million.
Wow. Wow. So basically four rootstocks, little Nemigard.
Very little
Nemigard.
Three
different type of hybrids.
Yeah.
Some hybrids that are more water-based, where they plant them in more perched area or
perched
heavier clay
area. Right.
Yeah, I know some of that.
There's a lot of demand for guys that want to plant trees in more rice ground, real heavy, mucky soils, and there's rootstocks that survive that. I mean, too much water is too much water for any rootstock, but there are rootstocks that can are more conducive to that. So with that being said, originally getting back to 2014, it was 80% Nemigard and Lovell, 20% hybrid. Now it's the opposite. So now we're doing about 15% Nemigard. Everything else is all Peach Elm and hybrid.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, hybrids are done in pots for the most part by a lot of nurseries. We still do it the old-fashioned way, bare root. And it's a very difficult way to do it, but we figured out a way, and the quality is really good.
The main thing, they got to get it planted on time. You have limited time with bare root. You got to get it in a certain time to maximize. I can see, you know, a lot of people could use pots too, but I do know we grow the most like that.
Yeah.
You know, I like planting with bare root.
I think bare root is by far the easiest. You plant it, set it, and forget it.
As long as you're on time, you got to be on time.
You got between December, ideally the earlier you plant the better.
Yeah, I don't believe in putting trees in cold storage.
December, January, and if you have to go to cold storage, we have done it. We've done it all the way up until June.
It's expensive.
Very
though.
Expensive, but hey, if you threw yourself in the water, now we got to get you out. So whatever
life
it takes.
Jacket.
Yeah.
Life jacket.
Yes.
So then from 2014, this gets us where we are today. We're, you know, where you're growing about as a 2.3 million trees this year? No.
This year we're growing about 3.2 million.
Yeah, I forgot to ask that question.
3.2 million, and you know, our sales have been very good. Of course, Viking is by far our most popular rootstock. We're sold out completely. Nemigard is really kind of second choice now, you know, to hybrids. Still, they planted a lot in really good soils where they have good water. It's okay.
Mm-hmm.
But now it's Hansen, GT2, and Viking. And now we're starting to get into Atlas a little bit. Atlas is a sister seedling of Viking. So I don't know if you're familiar, but both of those they're basically called interspecifics, where you have four different bloodlines in those rootstocks. So say your standard Peach Elm.
Are those breeded?
Yes.
Oh, really?
Yeah, Zager Genetics, of course, produced those. And and you have peach, almond, apricot, and plum bloodlines in them.
Man, that's so, over my head.
Yeah, so it's I don't know how they did it, but it's it it was that's the way
it's
they designed
seed,
those.
It's a cutting. It's a cutting.
It's a cutting. It's a cutting. Clonal. So
it's a tree they grew from a seed or something.
Right, and we used to grow them in the old days, like you grow vines, you know, big hardwood cuttings, and try to go from there. And that was the problem with those rootstocks is the failure from going to the nursery to the grower was huge. I used to have 50-60% losses.
Yeah, but you know, we've learned, you know, if something doesn't work, yeah, you better figure out how to fix it.
Figure it now.
You figure it out fast.
And the problem is, you know, we knew, or I personally knew that what had to be done, but trying to change the propagation department to do things differently than they knew how to do, it was a very hard task.
Change is tough.
But when I came here, you allowed me to do that, so I did what I did.
It's been a joy being a partner with you because we've learned so much. I've learned a lot from you, and one thing I do think you are super at is that you've been in this business so long that I think you are an expert of noticing tree problems in the field, because many times growers build, there's a problem with the tree, they blame the nursery guy.
It's always the nursery's fault.
We met in the Cross Ranch and we bought trees from you. And,
yes.
And on the highway over there, I actually, what happened was that we were thinning, you know, taking off the tops. What do you call them when you're suckering.
Suckering
the trees the first time, right? So I went out there, I figured, well, I'd save money by I showed the contractor how I wanted, raised the carton up only 3 inches above the carton, let everything grow. And I showed this guy like 15 different trees I wanted, so he got it. So that morning, I didn't go there first thing in the morning. I was having coffee with my father. And so I go around the corner, and all of a sudden, I see these guys are almost got 100 acres done, and he's 9 o'clock in the morning. Oh, my gosh. But all I see is like one little limb. You know, they're just running and stripping the trees as fast as they can because I paid them per tree. So, man, when I got around that corner, imagine how fast my truck's going, you know, just trying to get there to stop. So, anyways, getting back to the point that I was going to say, remember I called, hey, Connor, I got a problem with my trees.
Yes, and I went out there, and I remember that, and I said, how is this my problem? You know, you took off. Well, what happened is, you know, they took off too much, right?
I know. I just wanted some help. Right? The point is, I do, and you did, and now that's my problem. I said, you're absolutely right. It was kind of rude of me even to ask. But the point was, people do the trees like that, right? And
absolutely.
So, and sometimes we may have our problems, you know? But my biggest problem when I was growing nursery trees about you, you know, they say, your trees are turning out yellow. And I say, you're spraying Roundup, you know? Girl, I never spray no Roundup. Well, you got dead grass right there. I don't have that grass guy in that grass. Oh, well, maybe I did spray Roundup. So I learned early on, if they always blame Roundup, just take a tree in and do the tissue culture. And if you got Roundup in the tree, well, hey, man.
Yeah.
Someone got Roundup around you or something. But these are all things of growing that's, you know, it's part of the business.
Right.
No one's doing anything wrong, I'm saying, but it's interesting. So I know when you go out and evaluate a tree, you can actually tell super fast because of all the experience you've had doing this. And you've had this experience. Why don't you give a little insight of how long you've been doing this nursery thing, walking in fields, and tell a couple stories you might even have, but we won't say names.
Well, we talked about, you know, when I was in training with my mentor Dan Bonds, and said, how am I going to learn all this? And like he said, you know, once you get through it, you'll be like putting on your shoes in the morning. And he was right, because I mean, eventually, there's only certain things that can happen to a tree. And you learn what those things are. So you automatically go out there and look for these things, and you'll find what the problem is, you know. And of course, you know, in a lot of cases, you know, some people won't believe if you put compost in the hole or manures in the hole that's going to cook your roots. You got to be really careful with this.
I experienced that. Once that root goes through like a little ball, it burns that root.
It burns it. It cooks it. And so a lot of that time we try to do more than we need to that tree. That tree doesn't need much to get started. Whatever you want to do, you can do it after. Or if you're going to put manures or compost, you got to mix it up really good so you don't see it in the soil. So it's all mixed up really nicely and not in clumps. So those little things combined with when you see herbicides, you can see it. I mean, I've seen orchards where they had 100% herbicide.
Well, this is your experience. You get it.
You've seen it. You've seen it all.
People still might just have, they used to auger.
Yes.
Auger trees and plant trees. I was a young boy, and my dad was planting the Law Ranch where your office is right now, the first time in the 72. They had an auger machine out there planting 100 acres, and it was muddy. And anyways, part of that field we had to replant because the roots just stayed in like a little container.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, I had a situation like that. Like I said, you've been in this business for 40-something years. You get a chance to see it all and see those kind of
good
things.
Good and bad.
Good and bad, of course.
There's a big difference between farmers.
Mm-hmm. I had a grower that did that on the auger system, and I went out there on the second year, and these trees weren't growing. And, you know, somebody had recommended to him that he was going to fix it with a lot of fertilizers. And the minute I went out there and started digging trees up, I said, you better take them all out. These are never going to grow out of this. Because they were just going around in circles like in a pot.
Oh, my gosh. They spent all this money doing this. Mm-hmm. Now I might not even be able to have to replant it.
But, he finally realized that that's what it took. You had to bite the bullet, get it out, start over again, and never do that again. So
yeah, I've bit the bullet. I just replant them.
Well, and you get to see all these things going through life and just learning how to do a lot of things. And when you see a problem, it's easy to go out there and diagnose it because you know what's going on. You know the only things that can happen.
I'm a big fan of making sure your roots or root structure is healthy, because if you plant them off and like tree that might get muddy or some kind of it hurts the roots. And I think the roots may never recover, like messing your vascular system up. So kind of what I think. And if you start off planting on time, get it there, and the tree starts off growing great, you have a much better success rate than planting mucky ground or
absolutely
ground wet, stuff like that.
Soil conditions is everything, right?
Timing is everything.
Timing. And you go out there, and I tell a lot of growers, I mean, you know, do what's best for the tree, not what's best for your pocket.
Exactly.
That's
never
a big
sacrifice
deal.
Price for quality.
Exactly. There you go.
At the nursery company, you get them both.
Right.
That in there.
So, I mean, there's a lot of different ways, and we have forgotten a lot of times how important it is for trees that we actually look at how much money is going to cost us. Well, 5 cents, and you just lost a $7 tree. You know, it's not as important as it is. I mean, you just got to really focus on what you do, because you're looking at a 25-year investment, and you want to make sure that what you did done right.
Yeah, you wanted to return.
Absolutely.
Got to have more money coming in than going out.
The first thing, land prep is everything.
Everything, timing.
Once you plan it right on timing, then everything else just falls in place.
I think we'll do another podcast on that. We should do another podcast talking about how, you know, little illustrations of what we, how planting, how we do things, and how you maybe should.
I think it's
there's
great.
Really, there's not any classes no more to teach these people,
right.
Teach our growers.
Well, it's great because you got a chance to see and show what our experiences are and what to look for. And this thing has changed a lot in the last 10, 15 years. It really has.
It's going to keep changing, I guess.
How
too.
We do things, right? And I mean, we used to do it. You did it at one time, or you used to do it where you bring trees out and they prune the trees 100% right on the site before they plant. I'm always against that. You know, I've always been against that. I said, why? It's because it's cheaper. I said, oh, here we go.
Yeah,
you know?
Here we do.
So what if it cost you $5 more a tree to do it this way, but now you're doing two different jobs, two separate times, and you can focus on one thing. I understand people and managing people and how people think. So if you do things that way, you're going to get a better outcome.
Right.
And you allowed me to show it on one of your ranches, and you have never done it any different afterwards. So it's always been that way, and I think you're very successful with all your stuff.
So we've been partners now almost, what, 20 years?
16.
16 years.
Well,
started. I think we both aged well. We both aged well.
Right? Me a little more than you.
So, yeah, man, I'm going to end this here, but I want to do another podcast in, you know, a week or so or something when you get time. I think we'd like to do something about planting and different ways to do it. It'd be really cool.
That'd be great.
If you're up for that. All right, man.
Absolutely.
You're the best.
Thank you, Russell.
Adios,
appreciate
amigo.
It. Hasta luego.
Thanks for listening to the Almond Man Podcast, hosted by the one and only Russell Harris. Let's give a special shout out to our producers, Gabe Camarillo and Grant Myers, and the team at Root Creative. Until next time, take care and prosper.